I have a question about NKRV.
Yeah.
Why exactly do we need a Indian state to break the Indian National Congress into multiple linguistic sub-problems?
Why
did N.K. Gandhi think that it was a wise decision to break the INC into linguistic problems, sub-problems?
So the Congress was started in 1885, and for the first 30-odd years of its existence, it had members and participants from different parts of India. Mostly from the cities, so Madras as it was known, Bombay, Calcutta, Delhi, Lahore, and so on. And over time, it developed provincial units. And these units were based on the boundaries of the British Raj. So you had a Bombay Presidency Congress, a Madras Presidency Congress, a United Provinces Congress, and so on. And Gandhi comes back in 1950 from South Africa. By about 1920, he is firmly in charge of the Congress Party, and he decides to reorganize his units on linguistic lines. So instead of a Bombay Presidency Congress, you have a Maharashtra Congress for Marathi speakers, a Gujarati Congress for Gujarati speakers, instead of a Madras Presidency Congress for Telugu speakers, and so on. And I think Gandhi always emphasized the mother tongue. His own first language was Gujarati. Although he grew up, although he worked in South Africa, and his children were born in South Africa, he insisted on teaching them Gujarati first. So he had a great emphasis on the mother tongue. When he was working in South Africa, he recognized that India was the land of many languages. In fact, the journal he started, Indian Opinion, was printed in four languages: Hindi, Tamil, Gujarati, and English, to cater for the different groups of Indian immigrants there. And it may have been, I haven't confirmed this, but it may have been the first multilingual periodical in the world. It's quite possible. So you have a sense that mother tongue is very important. The language of your home, of your family, of your community is crucial to the way you think. Of course, you can acquire other languages. So Gandhi was a master of English prose. Those of you who read English know. He also, of course, knew Hindi. Late in life, he started learning Bengali because he was working for PC Bengali. Because he had Tamil followers who were very close and dear to him in South Africa, he also became a Tamil speaker. So he wasn't dogmatic about language. He recognized that people should be multilingual. And if there's any piece of advice I give young people, is learn some new languages. That I feel a sense of acute loss. So Tamil is my mother tongue, I could read it in that time. I didn't write Hindi because I grew up in Bengaluru. I wish I had learned more languages than I was young. But Gandhi saw the fundamental importance of the mother tongue. Now, also, Gandhi, among the reasons Gandhi emphasized the mother tongue was that he knew the Congress till that time was largely elite body, English speaking professionals who conversed with each other in English. So they were lawyers, doctors, professors, and he wanted to get peasants, artisans, adivasis, workers into the national movement. Again, the mother tongue was a vehicle for that. And so I think that was the essential impetus to broaden the basis of the freedom struggle, to get more people in, to have periodicals printed in the mother tongue. And his own message was carried through different languages. So in Kerala, in Malayalam, in Andhra, in Telugu, in Gujarati, in Gujarati, and so on. Now, so that was kind of the political background. From the 1920s and 30s, as the sense arose that India was about, India would one day become free, he said, when we become free, our provinces will be based on linguistic principles. And that's what eventually happened. And that's how we are today. Now, the question arises, was that wise, was that not wise? I myself think it was wise at that stage. Because if you look at what happened to Pakistan? Pakistan was created on the basis of religion. Jinnah said Muslims could not live as a minority in a Hindu-dominated India. They needed their own motherland. So Pakistan was created with two wings, west and east. Jinnah then said we need one language to unite them, which is Urdu. Urdu was imposed on the East Pakistanis to the detriment of Bengal. Black. Similarly, Sri Lanka. There was a civil war for 30 years because Sinhala was imposed on the country. So, I myself think it's a wise idea. Now, it doesn't mean it's an idea that is not capable of modification. So, if you ask me today, I feel then probably we need 40 states. Some of our states are too large. I mean, Andhra has been broken up. But there's no reason why Maharashtra should not be broken up. Why Maharashtra? You know, North Karnataka feels deeply victimized because they're so far away from us. I mean, the capital of Karnataka is Bangalore, in the south. So it's a, at the same time, linguistic states have created some tensions. You know, you live in Bangalore, so you know that Kannada speakers are in a minority. And they feel squeezed out by Tamil speakers and Hindi speakers and Telugu speakers. So, but on the whole, I feel that the creation of linguistic congress provinces was wise in that it deepened the basis of the national movement. It made it a popular struggle, not just a struggle of elite English speaking people. And the creation of linguistic states was also wise because it safeguarded the unity of India. I mean, look at what happened in Pakistan and Sri Lanka. I think Gandhi's wisdom is followed.
If you are witnessing the end of liberal democracy today, would it be wise to sustain the system or look for an alternative already? Also, it has been suggested that the left has had a monopoly over the country's intellectual psyche.
Yeah.
If so, where did the intellectuals fail in addressing this trend effectively, and how do we diagnose this?
The last part of the question, yeah.
Also, it has been suggested that the left has had a monopoly over the country's intellectual psyche.
Yes.
If so, where did the intellectuals fail in addressing this trend effectively, and how do we diagnose this? The rise of liberal democracy.
Impossible. I mean, among the lessons of history is that it's impossible to predict even the near future. You were witness to how experts got the results of the Karnataka election spectacularly wrong. Almost overnight. So it's very hard to predict what will happen. But overall, if you look at the history of the last 100 years, there seems to be a cycle. You know, a move towards the left and back towards the right, and it's kind of an oscillation. And I think this is a period in which the left is on the retreat and the right is on the ascent. Globally, with a few exceptions, but globally. 10 or 15 years ago, there was a rise of left-wing leaders in Latin America. You know, you had Chavez, you had Morales, you had all kinds of people who, whereas Latin America in the past had been ruled by right-wing dictators. So this kind of oscillation takes place. Now, so that's kind of normal, and which one should worry too much about it. What should worry about is the rise of what people are calling the strong man, or what Max Weber, who someone who is studying sociology textbooks, called a charismatic leader. And charisma is a complicated thing. At one level, charisma is appealing. You know, you want someone who can speak well, who has charm, who has a personality. But at the same time, as Max Weber famously warned, you know, charisma can also lead to dictatorship and authoritarianism. You know, you can go to the leader's head. And this kind of a charismatic authority which bypasses democratic institutions. Because liberalism is about, there are several aspects to liberal democracy. One, of course, is individual freedoms. So, where an individual must not be coerced by the family, the community, the religious order. The individual must have the freedom to think, to develop, to nurture their own ambitions, to enter into their own romantic relationships, to make their own friends. So that's one aspect of liberalism, which is the one which is often stressed rightly. But there's another very important aspect of liberalism or liberal democracy, which is independent institutions. So the judiciary, the press, the civil service, the police, though you have elections and a certain party comes to power, that party cannot make the judiciary, the bureaucracy, the press, the police simply an instrument of its own interests. Now, the rise of the strong man, and this is not new, it is happening in our states. Fortunately, Karnataka has escaped it. But if you look at Tamil Nadu under Jayalalitha, or even worse, Jayalalitha was at least an elected chief minister, Maharashtra under Balthakare, who had never won an election, but proudly said, under remote control of my government. And everyone deferred to him. You know, the police took their orders from him, the press took their orders from him, the bureaucrats. So, this kind of strongman phenomenon, which as I said, is not new, but now appears to be growing in countries that were previously immune to it. We had Indira Gandhi, who was a strong person of that kind of authoritarian. So that was before all of you were born. And Narendra Modi is very much in the Indira Gandhi board. Trump, you know, Trump's latest tweets, I will pardon myself. Now, it is astonishing that you know, in a country like America, which has strong and robust institutions, you can have that kind of phenomenon. Or Turkey, and Erdogan likewise is doing similar things. So I think we should worry about this oscillation left and right. You know, that is not necessarily unhealthy. In fact, it's good. If you have one party or one ideology domination, it's bad. If you look at our states, I'll explain why one party domination or one ideology domination is bad. If you look at our states, the fact that the left ruled Kerala for 40 years, West Bengal for 40 years, is one reason West Bengal is doing so badly. The fact that the left never could rule Kerala uninterruptedly but always had to alternate with the Congress is one reason Kerala has such good social indicators. Likewise, in Himachal Pradesh, it's one of our best performing states when it comes to women's education, health, and so on. So, if you alternate, actually, it's a check. One is a check on the other, and it could be good for democracy. So, if it appears temporarily that the right is ascendant, I as a Democrat would not worry about it. I would worry more about the rise of the strong man and the decline of impartial institutions. Okay. Now, your second question about the intellectual dominance of the left. This is true. If you have not read it, I wrote a long essay on the absence of a conservative intellectual tradition in India. It is available online, it was published in Caravan magazine and later in my collection, Democracy Dissenters. You could get it in Caravan magazine. And it has a long and detailed analysis of how the left came to occupy a position of dominance in our universities and why an excessive dominance by the left of our intellectual life is unhealthy for our democracy, and why we need a credible right-wing intellectual class, and however, why we haven't had it yet. So please read my essay, it has a much longer analysis and explanation than I can give you in the short answer. But certainly, for a vibrant political culture, you need parties of different kinds. For a vibrant intellectual culture, also you need thinkers, influential thinkers with different kinds of orientations. And I hope you do read the essay, otherwise you do read my essay. But I just highlight one of my explanations as to the fact as to why we do not have a robust right-wing intellectual class in India. Unlike, say, the United States, or Germany, or France, where you have many first-class conservative or right-wing intellectuals. In India, we do not. If I was to rank the 100 top historians in India, probably 50 would be leftists, 40 would be left of center, and maybe one or two might be, you know, right-wing. Now, this would not be the case in some other developing democracy. And the reason for this, I argue, is that the dominant political force of the right, the RSS, has always been extremely hostile to creative and independent thinking. And in my essay, I urge those interested in developing original right-wing ideas relevant to India to read the works of Chakravarti Rajagopalachari, who was the first pioneer of free market thinking in India through his Swatantra Party, who emphasized the role of religion, but was a thinker. He was not a crude bigot, which is effectively what the people in the RSS are. But please, you read my essay, you will get a long analysis. It is true, and I deplore, although I am not on the right myself, I deplore the fact that we do not have, that we have a unidimensional intellectual culture. That's bad. That's bad for thinking. If only one particular point of view dominates, that's not healthy in the universe.
It's one of the most important articles for itself. What do you think the future of study of history and culture will hold if even the institutions initiated to preserve history are going to do?
So, the Archaeological Survey of India for many years was headed by an IAS officer, not by a trained archaeologist. People complained about this, and there was the IAS officer gave up charge, and it was time to appoint a new director, The new director would not necessarily be the best archaeologist who was applied, but the one who has the best political contact, so the minister knows. And this is true not just of the archaeological survey, it is true of all our major universities. You know, in our state, the vice chancellor of Mysore University will not necessarily be the best person for the job. He will be the right class, he will be the right connection to the education minister, and so on and so forth. Right? So we have undervalued quality expertise. So if the archaeological survey, if you choose the best person as the director of the archaeological survey, and you give that person, he or she, the freedom for 10 years to nurture the institution, that person will recruit quality people at all levels. So it becomes a properly professional body, the way the National Trust in England is, or you know, any, or so on so forth, or the National Park Service in America, which maintains only one building exists. However, if the director is a political appointee, that person will tend to have his own chapters around everywhere, right? And this is the story of the deterioration of all our institutions as an archaeological survey. Because of this, because of political interference and the lack of cultivation of proper professionalism among these bodies, the bodies have decayed, they have not been able to maintain our monuments properly, and our monuments are declining. So we say, despair, let's give them to a private company, which is what has happened so far with the Red Fort, and may next happen with the Taj Mahal and other places. Right. So it is essentially, again, a product of this contempt for professionalism among our political class, not just the BJP. The Congress is equally guilty of all this. You know, again, I have written about this extensively in some of my writings. You know. So I think we undervalue scholarship when it comes to things like museums, and so on and so forth. We also undervalue science when it comes to our public infrastructure. I'll give you a concrete example from our state. About a year ago, there was a proposal to build a steel flyover. Okay. It so happened I was in the streets protesting. The first protest I was in for many years. Because it was clearly a dark idea. It was an idea, and you know, it had obviously some commercial considerations behind it. Now, what was tragic? Fortunately, the public protest forced the government to back off. Now, what was very peculiar is that Bangalore has India's leading scientific institute, the Indian Institute of Science, which is the only Indian institute which is ranked in the top 200 in the world. The Indian Institute of Science has one of the world's leading energy and transport experts. Any sensible government sitting in Bangalore would consult the relevant professor in IISc and say, we have to get so many people, 2 million people a day to the airport efficiently, what is the best way? And that expert would go and say, build a highway like this, or don't build a highway like this, have a fast plane instead, have a dedicated bus lane. Now, but, and this is not, I know, it is not that as if that particular minister or that particular government was unique. If a new metro rail is planned in Mumbai, as is happening today, those of you go to Mumbai, you will see the new metro rail being planned. I can tell you IIT Mumbai, which is the leading IIT, was not consulted. So there is a devaluing even of the in-house scientific knowledge we have in all our departments, which is leading to the decline of institutions, and the archaeological survey is just one example of this. So when we call ourselves a knowledge-based society, I can only laugh. Because it's true, there are some remarkably gifted scholars, scientists, archaeologists, energy experts, transport experts in India. But our government, regardless of party, never consults them because it is embarrassing and inconvenient to consult them.
So, had the partition not happened in 1947, would the situation of India be any different in terms of the political instability and internal hostility around the nation?
Yeah.
Or would it have eventually
happened? Well, that's a very good question. In a 4-month time period, you could have had systems in place to organize refugee movements to stop the communal violence. So, partition could have been done without loss of life, or with a less loss of life. However, would a united India have been better off? I doubt it very much. Firstly, and this is those who are nostalgic for partition don't understand. and some of you would have studied history, the only way partition could have been avoided was on the basis of the cabinet mission plan of 1946, which allowed the provinces to secede and, more importantly, left the state of the princely states undefined. So you would have had a united India and Hyderabad independent. So those of you who come from North India to study to center, this could not have come. Simple. So we could have a very weak center. Then we would have been a front right, say, in the Cold War. Because Pakistan was a buffer between us and Afghanistan, we did not have to take sides in the Cold War, which saved us enormous suffering. Pakistan is suffering because they sided, partly because they had to bear the cost of the Cold War with the Soviets, and then with Afghanistan and all the refugees. And they said in Pakistan that Pakistan's three greatest enemies are all A, Allah, America, and the army. Right. Now, if we had been one country, we would have to take sides. And would it be worse to be under the Russian yoke or the American yoke? God knows, right? So I think I am not nostalgic for that. However, it could have been handled differently. And above all, the most important thing for India today is that we should not be a Hindu Pakistan. The danger in India today is, particularly under current regime, to make us a Hindu majority state in which Muslims and Christians are treated the way Hindus and Christians are treated in Pakistan. So that is the object lesson we should learn. But in United India would not, the only way it would be better is that we had an even better PKD. That's all. And that just matter to be well.
Challenges to Indian democracy. There is Hindu fundamentalism, communist dictatorship, and ethnic separatism. So, could you please elaborate on how these factors affect our Indian democracy?
Substantial. I am happy about that. Ethnic separatism has increased in Kashmir, probably declined in Nagaland, stayed the same in Manipur. And Hindu fundamentalism has increased because it's in power in many states and in the center. And that really poses a danger to the ideals of our republic, to the ideals of the constitution. I think there is now a pushback. Not just in terms of the recent election results, but one way of looking at the pushback is the satire and the jokes about Modi on Twitter and Facebook. And you've seen some of the videos which show that people, you know, once you start mocking your leaders, and then that's all. So, but fortunately, since I wrote that essay, the threat of left-wing extremism has deceived. You know, again, I said that unlike some of my friends on the left, I don't see Pakistan as the honest broker in Kashmir. And unlike some of my other friends on the left, I don't see the Maoists as what one writer called Gandhians with guns. You know, they're bloodthirsty barbarians. They have a cult of violence, and you see the kind of things they've done in our Adivasi areas. They made the lord of the Adivasi even worse in the end. So I have shed no tears for the decline of Maoism. I'm glad the threat of Maoism is receding. However, I remain worried, go back to the essay, about ethnic separatism, particularly in these three states, Nagaland, Manipur, and Kashmir. Well, if you want to have a vote or a plebiscite today, it's likely that in all those three states, a majority would vote to give. So fortunately, you cannot have a vote. Constitutionally, you cannot have a vote. I'm glad about that. Because I don't want, you know, India breaking up 25 parts, that would be too many problems for us. But then this discontent has to be addressed. I've spoken about Kashmir, but also in Manipur. In Manipur, I'll give you one memory of Manipur. Manipur is in some ways the most complicated. Because in Kashmir, it is Kashmiri freedom fighters, often heavily influenced by radical Islam, wanting freedom from India. In Nagaland, it is Naga freedom fighters, often influenced by Baptist missionaries, wanting freedom from India. In Manipur, it's much more complicated. It's a three-way fight. You have the Maitis of the valley who want freedom from India. You want the Nagas of the uplands who want to join the Nagas of Nagaland, and you have the Kukis of the upland who want freedom from the Maitis and the Nagas. So it's a very, you know, very complicated ethnic rivalries. There were 26 insurgent groups in Manipur. And they all call guns from time to time. And they all extort money from citizens. I mean, when I was in Imphal, the person taking me around, and since there's some professors of yours here, you know, I should tell the story because it shows how lucky they are and I am, okay, to be academics here. I was going around, the person taking me around Imphal was the professor of economics, a very respected scholar. And I found that all the houses were unpainted. So I asked him, he said, look, if I paint my house, the next day an insurgent group will come and say, give me 5 lakhs, so clearly some money has come to you. So this is the kind of fear that people live under. Fear of the gun of the insurgents and of the Indian government. So in these 3 states, I think, there are problems. And so I'd say, because we are essentially, in terms of the threats to our republic, we are really where we were 10 years ago. Because the threat from left-wing revolutionaries has receded, but the threat from right-wing fundamentalists has increased.
First, our Prime Minister didn't comment on a recent incident that occurred with the rape of Asita from Katwal. Our Prime Minister first didn't comment on this for a few days. Then on news channels, party representatives were arguing about under whose rule more rapes had occurred. Then after deliberation, a law was passed that sentenced rapists to minors to death. Can you please comment on the political motivation behind this and the efficiency of such a law?
I've almost been pretty everywhere. But I think the Prime Minister's silence on many things has eroded the moral authority of his office, not of him personally. And that is just one example. You know, Katwa is one example. There are things on which he could have spoken. You know, he doesn't have to speak on everything. People say, yeah, you know, I don't think a person is obliged to speak on everything. However, I'll tell you what he could have spoken on again, well before Katwa, which is the attack on the women's hostel in Banaras Hindu University. It's his constituency. And the police went in. You remember the case where there was discrimination in the university. Women were not allowed non-veg food. Women were not allowed access to the internet after 5 p.m. They believed the library. There was no internet on the rooms. And they were not allowed cell phones also. And the men were allowed everything. And they were protesting, and then the police went in. And it is happening. You are talking about Beti Bachao, Beti Padao. It is in your own constituency, for God's sake, they're helping your honesty. So I think, having the ability to speak out, to say, I'm sorry, you know, I think it will do a great deal to restore respect. Even if you're apologizing on behalf of the institution, not person. You know, I think that is something that is, Gandhiji once said, I made a Himalayan blunder. Not a Hungarian blunder, I made a Himalayan blunder, right? Now, how many of us are willing to recognize even a small mistake we made? In the case of Katwa, Rahul Gandhi was silent for a long time. And there was so much pressure on him on social media that he joined the candlelight march. But without the pressure on social media, he would not have said anything. And if Rahul Gandhi had not done the candlelight march, the Prime Minister would have also stayed shut. And finally he said something. So I think, you know, and this depends the office, it's not that depends your person. You know, you must have the generosity to say, you know, that our government has failed, our institutions have failed. And of course, the worst thing in Katwa was that BJP MLAs were part of the procession, defending the people. No. I think that is something which was deeply. So, but should you overreact in terms of this punitive, carelessly thought out law? You know, that I'm not sure.